how can we describe particles in quantum mechanics? The Schrödinger equation takes the Hamiltonian p squared over 2m, but this is the classical energy-momentum relation. The Klein-Gordon equation has a relativistic energy-momentum relation, where the energy is given by e squared equals p squared plus m squared, but in this equation we have a second-order time derivative, which is the cause for some problems regarding the probability density. This means for the Dirac equation, we want a relativistic energy-momentum relation, and we want only a first-order time derivative. A general Schrödinger-type equation looks something like this. I dt acting on psi is a Hamiltonian acting on psi. And for this Hamiltonian, we make the following ansatz. We assume that there is momentum and mass with some coefficients alpha and beta acting on the wave function psi. This means we have to find out the coefficients alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, and beta. Our condition that this is a relativistic energy-momentum relation is that if we apply the Hamiltonian twice, it should yield p squared plus m squared, or in terms of indices, pi pi plus m squared. Let's find out what this condition implies. We have alpha k pk plus beta m times alpha j pj plus beta m, and this should be pi pi plus m squared. Notice two things. First, we left out the sum sign in these terms, following Einstein's summation convention. And secondly, we chose a different index in the second term, j instead of k, to avoid any ambiguity. If we multiply these terms and keep their relative orderings, we end up with something like this. Let's first look at the terms without any momentum. This means beta m on the left and m squared on the right. Beta squared should be equal to 1, and we have our first condition. Next, we look at terms with only one momentum. This means these two terms on the left and nothing on the right. So we have alpha k pk beta m plus beta m alpha j pj has to vanish. If we rename some indices, changing j into k, we can pull out a pk to the right and we arrive at this condition here. This means that the anti-commutator of alpha k with beta has to vanish. Now onto the terms with two momenta. We have alpha k pk alpha j pj on the left and pi pi on the right. Here we can do a trick. We write this term again, but rename some indices, making k to j and j to k. So this term is exactly the same as before. If we add them and put a 1/2 in front of them, nothing has changed. But now we can pull out a pk pj to the right, and we're left with an anti-commutator again, meaning that the anti-commutator of alpha k alpha j has to be 2 times the Kronecker delta kj. Now we finally have our third condition. It's worth noticing that the condition that an anti-commutator has to vanish is kind of strange, because usually it doesn't matter if we write x and y or y times x. Normally it just gives 2xy. And if this has to vanish, either the one or the other variable inside the anti-commutator has to vanish. But if we remember our ansatz for the Hamiltonian, this means that either the momentum or the mass drops out, and that can't be. So the smart thing that Dirac noticed was that if alpha and beta are not numbers but matrices, we can fulfill this condition without alpha and beta being zero. And if alpha and beta are matrices, then the thing they're acting on, the wave function psi, also has to be a column vector instead of a scalar function. That's pretty much it. Thanks for watching and see you next time.